We're continuing on in Revelation. Summaries are getting shorter and shorter. Tonight we're dealing with that woman. Which woman? That woman. Jezebel. This is where it comes from. It comes from older scriptures dealing with Jezebel, and it comes to life in Revelation. Quick summary here in our first, we're up to our fourth assembly tonight. First three assemblies, there's a quick chart there. I'm not really going to go into them, but on your last column, you can see there was the tree of life. If you don't obey me, you'll lose your candlestick, the tree of life. In our second assembly, there was the crown of life, and you'll escape the second death. And in the last assembly last week, there was the hidden manna, the white stone, and you'll get a new name. Thanks. Just to click in where we're up to. So tonight we're going to the assembly at Thyatira. Number four. I was wrong last week. We didn't finish chapter two. We're finishing chapter two tonight. So letter number four. Quick. You can sit wherever you want, mate. Sit wherever you want. We'll sit there. You can see the screen. Go on. No point if you can't see the screen. Letter number four is to the believers at Thyatira, which we hear of in Acts 16 as a stop on Paul's journey, where he met a woman named Lydia, who became the first recorded person to accept Yahusha during that tour. You can see up there, I won't blow it up, but there's all the assemblies up there in Asia. So this woman Lydia, she was a seller of purple, which this small village was famous for. Thyatira was famous for that. Totally different than the magnificent cities and centers of learning that were in Ephesus, Smyrna, and Pergamos. And yet here too existed a Jewish population and therefore a synagogue, and now an established population of new covenant believers in Yahusha also. And this is who he's writing to. Thyatira, a quick summary here. This word was interesting because the word Thyatira means a dominating female, a woman, a daughter, or feminine oppressor. Sacrifice of the mass or burning incense, a sweet sacrifice of labor or contrition, humility. And as we know, a woman is the symbol for a bride or an assembly, whether true or false. And we will see the emphasis of that woman, in this letter. So Yahusha begins this letter. Write this to the messenger of the assembly in Thyatira. I am the son of Yahuwah, with eyes like a flame of fire and feet like burnished brass. So listen to me. He's identifying himself yet again. It's sad that he has to, but this is the stage. He has to identify himself. He's the son of Yahuwah, and he's also, we'll get to this, it says it right here. Many Yisraelite kings, as we're discovering, were referred to as the son of Yahuwah in ancient times. So apart from his divinity as the Creator's son, this letter is also coming from their literal national king, from the royal line of David. He's letting them know, I'm legit, I'm from the line of David, I'm Yahusha. But as he described his eyes and feet through language used by Daniel and Ezekiel to describe the ancient one, Yahuwah, the Father, it's obvious that this divine being is Messiah Yahusha himself. And as we've dealt with, he's Yahuwah in the flesh. They're the same being. Another reason, another interesting reason he uses the words eyes of fire and feet of brass. As with most other cities, paganism thrived in Thyatira. Their sun deity was Apollo, next in power to his father Zeus, and he was represented by flaming rays and feet of burnished brass. That was the national deity of the town. So how does Yahusha rock up? That's nothing. I'm the one with the flame of fire. I'm the one with the feet of brass. That's nothing. So this is another reason for Yahusha's self-description, as well as the fact that Thyatira had a local guild of brass coppersmiths there, being one of their specialty trades. Brass, interestingly, is also a symbol of the judgment of sin. So what Yahusha's eyes of fire discern, will see, his feet of brass will judge. You found that in your life, haven't you? Yahusha goes through everything, and what he sees, he judges. He wouldn't have been that black either. Not quite. I just like the picture. He wouldn't have had that, not that black. It's a cool picture though. Dark, but not that dark. He says, I see all your behavior, love, service, belief, and also your endurance. He's talking to this assembly here. He sees everything. I see your behavior, your love, service, belief, also your endurance. So good on you guys, for your behavior is getting better and better every day, and it's affecting many others too. Other translations say your work is better now than at the first. Your latter work is better than the first. It's getting better and better. Unlike Ephesus, who had lost their first love, these guys were growing and being even more effective now than in the beginning. But sadly, this letter contains the most encouraging praise and yet the most damning disapproval by Yahusha that's given to the seven assemblies. Out of all the seven assemblies, there's the most highest of praise and critique for one assembly. We're going to come into that. So he's really happy with how they're growing and doing everything, but I do have a major problem with you allowing that woman, Jezebel, who actually calls herself a prophetess, to teach and lead my servants astray into dirty whoring and eating food offered to idols. And she's unchallenged. No one will challenge her. Some versions say your wife, Jezebel, as in this is the assembly leader, the messenger's wife, just like Jezebel was the wife of King Ahab in the ancient texts. Could be. But is anybody catching a repetitive theme in these letters? So we've mentioned Jezebel now. Her literal name wasn't Jezebel. It's just talking about a type of woman. Sexual sins and food issues seem to be rampant and also at the top of Yahusha's list of things he hates. And by comparing this unnamed woman to Jezebel, who was the wife of the wicked King Ahab, the accusation is that she is a supporter of idolatry, paganism, and everything that is anti-Torah. So Jezebel's goal in the ancient text, back in the time of Yisrael, Jezebel's goal was to rid Yisrael of Yahuwah's Torah, obedience, and set-apart lifestyle, and she was well on her way to doing it. So we must assume that this Jezebel woman's goal was similar, or she herself was deceived. Why else would Yahusha be referring to this woman as Jezebel? How did this Jezebel woman wind up getting such influence in this assembly? Because she claimed to be a prophetess. A person claiming knowledge has always been a magnetic draw for Yahuwah's people. But by the time of the early assembly writings, the term prophet had evolved somewhat. And for a follower of Yahuwah, who held fast to the scripture, it meant more of a teacher of Yahuwah's word, because in general it was believed among the Jews that the era of the prophets was over and any communication from Yahuwah was contained in the scriptures. And I think they still believe that too. They still don't believe in Yahusha. Anything you have to know is in the scriptures. So the prophets were over. However, there were those, and always will be, those who honestly think they hold the office of a prophet along the lines of Daniel and Ezekiel, and that they are regularly shown the future and given special knowledge, lifting themselves up. But the truth is, as we know, my sheep hear my voice. All of them, if you tap in. All of us can hear it. You don't have to have a title of a prophet to hear Yahusha's voice. We can all hear Yahusha's voice. How many thoughts does it give us every day? You got to tap in. So this Jezebel woman, a false prophet, had tricked plenty of people in the assembly, including the leadership. The thrust of her teaching was to deny the word of Yahuwah and to deceive people into believing that Yahuwah personally gave her new laws and commands that apparently revoked the old laws and commands. Just like freedom and liberty today are taken to the furthest extreme, allowing outright disobedience. Oh, we can do what we want. Who shall forgive us? Mm-mm. And the two most serious crimes in Yahusha's eyes were her teaching to eat food sacrificed to idols and committing sexual sins. That was what she was on about. So we know who she is now. What did Yahusha say? I gave her time to repent of her whoring and her idolatry, but she refuses to give up her lucrative business. Apparently someone in the assembly had the guts to confront her and tell her what she was doing was evil. So she wasn't naive or innocent in her behavior, but the leadership didn't have the same guts to put her out in order to save the other believers. Those believers who she was infecting with lies. Why wouldn't the leadership act? Probably the age-old reason. The woman was popular, had a following, and the leadership didn't want to rock the boat. They also likely confused love with tolerance. So he's given her a chance to repent. She wouldn't repent. So now I'm throwing her and all her idolatrous sexual partners into a deathbed and will heap great affliction and torment on them. Unless, of course, they repent of their wicked behavior. I'll even kill all her children so that all the assemblies will know that outward appearances and show don't impress me. Outward appearances and show do not impress me. For I'm the one searching hearts with X-ray vision, and I'll dish out favor or consequences to each person according to their behavior. Just as we just sung a song about that. Obedient receive favor. He searches the hearts. Doesn't matter what you're doing on the outside, you can't fake it. He's not into show or keeping up appearances. He's searching the hearts, and he is the rewarder, good and bad. This is an attribute of Yahuwah that we hear about all throughout the ancient writings, that he will dispose of many evil people for the sake of protecting the remainder of his people who have not yet fallen. And the hope is also that people far and wide will fear Yahuwah when they hear about what he did, and that this fear will keep them from doing the same thing, even if they were about to. So, this was just a little bit more about the topic of Jezebel. I thought this was interesting. In Thyatira, there was a prophetess called Sambel, also Sibyl, a mixture of paganism and Jewishness, making a syncretistic religious cult. We know that was happening all over at this time. Still is. The oracle of Sambel was a woman endued with the spirit of prophecy just outside the city, and many came to consult this oracle for guidance. So it could be some of this coming into the assembly. These are all hypotheses, all these suggestions. There was also a prophetess who conducted pagan rites in the temple worship of Apollo, the sun deity, where women controlled the worship through sensuality and the spirit of divination, guiding the affairs of men. So, however the specifics, she was now in the assembly, bringing in idolatry and immorality. For her, it was permissible to be involved in the idol temples and the orgies that went on in them. How does Yahusha feel? We did it last week about mixture, bringing a mixture of behavior into the assembly, particularly of a sexual nature. He hates it. I think we've all felt it ourselves, haven't we? We've all felt that pressure of anything really that he hates. The name Jezebel is symbolic, meaning princess, without cohabitation, chaste, island of the habitation, Isle of the Dung Hill. She was true to so much of her name. Another few things about this woman. Remember the woman with the spirit of divination, spirit of the python that Paul had to deal with in Acts 16? Another interesting thing is if we look at Yahushua's seven parables and the seven assemblies, when Yahushua spoke parables, he said there were seven of them. A lot of sevens in Scripture. There were seven parables and there's a seven assemblies here in Revelation. The middle parable has a woman who hid leaven in the meal loaves until it was all leavened. See this, can't read them, but there's seven parables. In the middle parable, there was a wicked woman who sowed leaven, which spread out into all the other loaves. And here in the middle assembly here, we've got a wicked woman spreading leaven to affect everybody's behavior. Interesting patterns in Scripture. Right here in the middle assembly of the seven, there's a woman, Jezebel, teaching and seducing the bride of Yahuwah. Both middles of the sevens involve a woman. Jezebel is the only woman recorded in Scripture. This was funny. Jezebel is the only woman recorded in Scripture who painted her face, scaring ridiculous religious women today away from wearing makeup. You can't wear makeup. Don't want to look like a Jezebel. Ridiculous. Jezebel's judgment is recorded in 2 Kings 9, where she was thrown out of a window. There she is, getting thrown out of a window. And the dogs licked her blood and ate her flesh. That, in the natural, King Ahab's wife, that's how she died. Yahuwah used King Jehu to fulfill the judgments of Elijah's prophetic word upon this dominating female and feminine oppressor, a daughter of Baal worship, a false prophetess, and a murderer of the prophets of Yahuwah. She introduced idolatry, image worship, and the kissing of Baal, setting up an idolatrous priesthood, prophetic religion. She also shed the blood of Yahuwah's believers. So for this woman in the early assembly to be referred to as a Jezebel, what kind of woman is she? No other women get referred to as a Jezebel in Scripture. So she must have been pretty wicked. She did not come into the elect nation of Israel by birth or by favor, as Ruth did, or as Rahab the harlot did. She came in by marriage, one which was forbidden by the word of Yahuwah. It was an illicit union, and she was a teacher and seducer of the people of Yahuwah. That's Jezebel in the natural. So this woman in Thyatira was still flying with the image of a woman throughout the Scripture. This woman in Thyatira exerted corrupting influence in the assembly and took on the very nature and character of this ancient wicked woman. Because the same spirit, that's the key, we're not bashing women here tonight, it's a spirit that we're talking about. Just so happens it's in a woman tonight in this theme, but it's a wicked spirit. This same wicked spirit that ruled this woman in Thyatira was the same spirit that ruled Jezebel in Yisrael. Whose spirit is it? Satan, yeah, the devil. The spirit behind the idol was the spirit that controlled Jezebel, who in turn controlled her husband, who then controlled Yisrael. It is the same spirit developing basically the same corrupt doctrines and practices under different names and using different methods to bring about the same evil and corrupt ends, the destruction of Yahuwah's assembly. Because yes, the devil knows if he can get the assembly to be disobedient, they'll be destroyed. Satan's spirit of Jezebel, a false prophetess, teacher, and seducer of the people of Yahuwah. Each of these seem to have the same doctrine and deeds, idolatry and immorality. Idolatry, wrong food, because it's all kept up in the idolatry and temple worship, and immorality. All sexual behavior outside of the marriage bed is considered immorality. This same spirit is seen fully developed in Revelation 17, we'll get there, where she is then revealed as the mother of harlots, the great whore who has corrupted the nations, not just the king, the whole nations in this one, of the earth with the wine of her filthiness and fornications and whoring. Look at the look on her face. The arrogance of it all. So we've dealt with Jezebel. This is the woman. Yahushua's going to judge her, throw her into a sickbed, and all her followers will be killed as well. Now let me tell you and the rest in Thyatira that if you don't get sucked into this wicked teaching of Jezebel or into the depths of Satan, as they call them, then I won't make your life any harder for you, because you'll have enough drama when you boot that woman out. You don't need me giving you any. Just keep guarding what you have until I return. This was interesting here, this depths of Satan thing. I hadn't heard that expression before. Depths of Satan is the lifting up of oneself through knowledge and Gnostic intelligence, which was manifest big time here and is the counterfeit of the depths of Yahuwah in 1 Corinthians 2, which brings a person down into humility. The depths, getting deeper into Yahusha, the depths of Yahuwah brings you to humility, whereas the depths of Satan makes you puffed up. Speaking of leaven, considering that it was the Gnostic philosophers that had great influence at this time, and we know from other documents that the Gnostics were a constant thorn in the side of believing assemblies. They even wrote books pretending to be the disciples. That was what that whole Da Vinci Code thing was. They even wrote books pretending to be disciples and giving instructions. This was the Gnostics, intellectuals. So they were a constant thorn in the side of the believing assemblies that likely these deeper things were indeed based on Gnostic philosophies. Gnosticism invariably touts the human intellect as supreme, and so intelligent people are said to gain greater spiritual understanding than ordinary people, opposite to Yahusha's way. But we've all experienced that, even in Messianic Nazarim, the bride, we've all experienced this coming at us, the whole intellectual thing, the whole carpetbagger thing. The enemy within was worse than the enemy without. So Satan's tactics have always been, if you cannot destroy them from without, then corrupt them from within. So Yahushua finishes by saying, everyone who overcomes and guards the behavior I'm teaching you until the end will have authority over the nations and will shepherd them, leading with a rod of iron. And nations will be as fragile as a clay pot which is broken to pieces, unable to push back. The nations will be unable to push back. Psalm 2 is all about that. I had it written here, but it was too long, so I got rid of it. But Psalm 2 is using the exact same language. Rod of iron, nations will be as fragile as clay. They won't be able to fight back. We'll have that authority. So Yahushua says, my father gave this authority, this gift of authority to me, and now I'm sharing it with you. You'll even have the morning star. If you've got ears, and listen to what the Spirit says to the assemblies. The morning star. The morning star rises in the dark. It's the first star that you see. The morning star rises in the dark to usher in the new day. Yahushua is the morning star. It says that in Revelation. I forget the chapter. Later on, he says, I'm the bright and morning star, the root and offspring of David, the bright and morning star. So Yahushua is the morning star. Once again, it stands for Yahushua. You'll have me. And as the wise men saw the star in his first coming, so shall the overcomer receive the star relative to Yahushua's second coming. For he came as a star firstly, but will be a blazing force of radiation and perfection at his return. He won't just be a little star. He'll be ripping apart the fabric of the universe. He is the new light breaking through to the hearts of the believers as he opens an interdimensional portal within them, just like the Shekinah esteem in the earlier tabernacle and temple. This also corresponds to the tree of life, which we dealt with, the immortality, second death, the hidden manna, and the white stone, as promised, the overcomers also. So that's what we're promised, guys, if you overcome and guard the behavior. What's the revolution we're in? Behavior. You got to guard the behavior. So that's the end of Revelation 2. I said it last week, but it's actually true this week. It's the end of Revelation 2. All right? So, yeah. Interesting. Yeah. So there's lots of promises. I haven't said goodbye yet. What do you turn the cameras off for? Does anybody want to add anything? Anything you found interesting? Any questions? Oh. We're religious people. The religious people go on about the Jezebel spirit and this and that and this and that. Oh, they don't want to get sucked into that Jezebel spirit like it's a full-on doctrine. It's just Satan. It's just the devil. He just happened to use a particular woman. But religion has to cut everything up and make doctrines out of everything. But when you look through it with Yahushua's spirit, it's just the devil again. And in this particular story, he used a woman. But doesn't he use us if we let him? So that's what we have to overcome. And what were the two things with Jezebel? Encouraging them to worship idols, and the food was involved in that. And sexual immorality, which practically runs this world. Yahushua wants us to be clean. If you're not, you feel it. It blocks you, cuts you off. Miserable. Sin equals misery. So that's what we have to fight off. Done. Thank you, brothers and sisters. We'll see you next week. Bye. Now you can turn them off.